Hi, my name is Chloe O'Connell, and I'm currently an anesthesiology resident at Mass General Hospital. I'm going to talk today about some research I conducted with the Stanford ML Group under the supervision of Andrew Ng and Matthew Lungren while completing my master's in biomedical informatics out at Stanford. Our project is titled Deep Learning Assistance for Physician Diagnosis of Tuberculosis Using Chest X-rays in Patients with HIV. Hi, my name is Chloe O'Connell, and I'm currently an anesthesiology resident at Mass General Hospital. I'm going to talk today about some research I conducted with the Stanford ML Group under the supervision of Andrew Ng and Matthew Lungren while completing my master's in biomedical informatics out at Stanford. Our project is titled Deep Learning Assistance for Physician Diagnosis of Tuberculosis Using Chest X-rays in Patients with HIV. First, a little bit of background on TB. It's currently the most common cause of HIV-related death, and although treatable, it remains undiagnosed almost half the time. The gold standard for diagnosis is currently culture, but this can be difficult for a variety of reasons. It takes a while, up to 8 weeks to result, and requires sputum, which can be particularly challenging to obtain in patients with HIV due to their depressed immune systems. Furthermore, it's invalid if contaminated, and therefore can often produce an inconclusive result. The most notable alternative to culture diagnosis is the expert MTB-RIF assay, which is a gene assay that relies on PCR to detect genetic material of TB. It's significantly faster than culture, taking around 2 hours compared to 2 weeks, and has a sensitivity and specificity approaching that of culture. However, the high startup costs for this assay mean that it isn't widely available in developing countries. And a recent study found that only about 4% of cases are diagnosed this way when it comes to HIV and TB co-infection, despite the high performance of this assay. It also requires sputum, which can be difficult to obtain, particularly in patients with HIV, who again are often sputum scarce. As a result of the limited availability of expert testing and the cumbersome nature of culture diagnosis, a variety of adjunct diagnostic tools are commonly used in practice. Perhaps the most important of these is the chest X-ray, which can be quickly obtained at many medical centers. However, just because chest X-rays can be obtained doesn't necessarily mean they can be interpreted, as there are shortages of radiologists in many low-resource settings. In addition, patients with both HIV and TB often don't have the typical cavitary lesions on chest X-ray that we think of when we think of tuberculosis and chest X-rays, making the diagnosis of TB and HIV-positive patients a particularly challenging task. Our goal in this study was to develop a diagnostic algorithm that could detect TB using a combination of chest X-rays and clinical information in patients with a known diagnosis of HIV. Next, we sought to determine whether access to the algorithm's output could help clinicians make the diagnosis themselves in a simulated clinical environment. Onto our methods. The data we used were from two pre-existing data sets that had been collected as part of two clinical studies on HIV-TB co-infection in South Africa. They consisted of 305 and 378 patients, respectively, with a known diagnosis of HIV, who presented to two different hospitals in South Africa with symptoms concerning for TB co-infection. Clinical, lab, and imaging information were collected, along with the results of TB diagnostic studies. These data sets were combined and randomly split into a training set of 563, as well as a test set of 114 patients. The prevalence of TB diagnosis was slightly over 40% in both training and testing data sets based on culture or expert gene assay results. Next, we developed an algorithm to determine the likelihood of TB diagnosis. A patient's chest X-ray was first fed into a 121-layer dense net architecture, which had been pre-trained on Chexpert, a large data set of chest X-rays. This was used to extract image features as a 1024-dimensional vector, which was then used as input for two separate modules. The first, the findings module, was a linear classifier which attempted to diagnose X-ray findings that had been labeled by a trained radiologist, for example, cavitation or pleural effusion. The second, which we named the TB module, consisted of a linear layer to learn 20 unsupervised image features from the original 1024 dimensions, which were then combined with the 8 clinical covariates that we selected based on availability in both datasets. These consisted of the patient's age, oxygen saturation, hemoglobin, CD4 count, white count, temperature, current antiretroviral therapy status, and the patient's prior history of TB. These were then fed into a 2D neural network, the output of which was combined with the output from the findings module in order to obtain a predicted probability of TB diagnosis for that particular patient. Next, we developed a web-based TB diagnostic assistant for clinicians that integrated the algorithm's predicted probability of a TB diagnosis with the clinical input, chest x-ray, and a class activation map, or CAM, which highlighted regions of the chest x-ray that had had the greatest influence on the algorithm's decision. We then recruited a group of 13 clinicians in South Africa who commonly diagnose tuberculosis in patients with HIV in primary care and hospital settings with a range of 6 to 25 years of experience. They were asked to attempt to diagnose TB based on the patient's chest x-ray and clinical data in one of two conditions, either with or without the assistance of the algorithm's output. Cases were randomly assigned to each of the two conditions, and the diagnostic accuracy with and without assistance was then assessed using a logistic mixed effects model with physicians and cases as random effects. The diagnostic accuracy of assisted physicians compared with the algorithm alone was also compared using a logistic mixed effects model. Here we have what the clinician saw when they were viewing the case in the assisted mode. As you see, at the bottom of the CAM, there is a scale showing the algorithm's prediction of the likelihood that that patient has TB. Here's what they saw when they were viewing the case in unassisted mode. You see that there is no CAM, nor is there a likelihood of the patient having TB according to the algorithm. All they have is the raw clinical information and the patient's chest x-ray. In order to get a sense of the importance of clinical variables in pre-training, we also conducted two sensitivity analyses. The first compared the AUC of our model on the test set to that of a model trained on only chest x-rays without clinical variables. The second looked at an identical model with the same inputs that had been pre-trained on ImageNet instead of the dataset of human chest x-rays. And now on to our results. This table summarizes the demographic characteristics of our cohort. As you can see, the datasets were relatively similar in terms of age, mean oxygen saturation, and the other clinical variables. On average, patients with TB appear to be slightly more leukopenic, 8.7 and 9.7 versus 11.7 and 11.8, as well as anemic, hemoglobins of 8.8 and 9 versus 10.7 and 10.3. One other thing to point out is that 100% of the patients in dataset 1 had a cough, as this was an inclusion criterion for this dataset, while dataset 2 included other symptoms of TB as inclusion criteria, including fever, night sweats, weight loss, etc. Here we have a raw plot of physicians' accuracy with and without the model's assistance, along with the model's accuracy on the same randomly selected test cases. The model's accuracy varies between participants because we've plotted not an average accuracy on the test set, but the model's accuracy on the cases that each participant viewed with model assistance. When we look at the mean performance across clinicians, they overall performed better when they were able to see the model's output. Our primary outcome was accuracy, and this reached statistical significance according to the mixed effects model likelihood ratio test when comparing assisted to unassisted clinicians. However, the increase from 60 to 65% is of questionable clinical significance. The model alone was able to achieve an accuracy of 79%, significantly outperforming the assisted clinicians. However, we do see that this is driven largely by a large increase in specificity, though this was admittedly a post-hoc analysis and not assessed for statistical significance. In fact, the model was very slightly less sensitive than both unassisted and assisted clinicians, possibly representing clinicians' understandable reluctance to let cases go undetected and untreated. Finally, when we look at the sensitivity analyses, we see that models that did not include the clinical variables and instead were trained only on chest x-ray images did not perform as well in the test set. The same goes for Chexpert pre-training, the dataset of chest x-rays, as a model pre-trained on only ImageNet achieved a test set accuracy of 0.64 compared to 0.78 for the full model. Notably, models trained on one dataset and evaluated on the other also appear to suffer in terms of accuracy and AUC, as we can see in the last two rows, although it's unclear how much of this decrement in performance is due to reduced sample size and how much is due to lack of generalizability across samples. So to summarize, we've presented the performance of an algorithm we developed designed to diagnose tuberculosis in patients with HIV based on their chest x-rays and clinical data. We also explored whether this algorithm could be used to improve clinician performance in a simulated clinical environment and found that use of the algorithm resulted in performance improvements of statistical but questionable clinical significance. We also found, somewhat surprisingly, that the algorithm alone far outperformed both clinicians alone and clinicians able to see the algorithm's output. One question this brings up is why the assistant clinicians who had access to the algorithm's output were less accurate than the algorithm alone. Possible explanations include a lack of confidence in the algorithm's output, as well as an understandable reluctance to miss positive TB cases, given the increased clinical consequences when compared to missing a negative case. When it comes to study design, there is also a possibility that the presence of a quote-unquote possible category for cases with an estimated probabilities near 50% did not give clinicians enough guidance to guess correctly on these cases. These categories were used in the place of probabilities in order to limit the cognitive load of processing algorithm output, but it would be interesting to see whether including exact probabilities resulted in assisted clinician performances that were closer to that of the algorithm alone. It's worth mentioning that there's been some prior work in applications of deep learning in the diagnosis of TB and/or identifying characteristic findings in chest radiographs, with some reporting considerable success with AUCs as high as 0.98 to 0.99. However, it's important to note that these have largely utilized datasets composed of healthy or asymptomatic screening populations, in addition to active TB cases, which means that almost any chest x-ray with an abnormal finding could be easily classified as a case. This is a considerably easier problem to solve than the diagnosis of TB in HIV positive patients, which is a much more difficult problem even for trained radiologists. In the case of differentiating HIV and TB co-infection compared to chest x-rays with other abnormal findings, expert performance has been reported with sensitivities and specificities as low as 0.68 and 0.53, respectively. In terms of the limitations of this study, one important one is the presence of a simulated diagnostic environment in which the clinician had access to far less information than they would in a clinic setting. We were also unable to stick to only the gold standard for diagnosis, which is culture, given practical constraints of our data set, and had to also rely on expert MTB-RIF in some cases. While this assay has reported specificities approaching 100% even in HIV-positive populations, this discrepancy is worth noting. We also chose to focus on accuracy as a first step and did not include a cost-benefit analysis of the sensitivities and specificities achieved by each group. This would be an important next step if a similar algorithm were to be investigated for real-world clinical use, as the cost of missing a positive case may not be as great as the cost of missing a negative one. This is even more relevant given that the significant gains made by the algorithm were seen in terms of specificity, not necessarily sensitivity. Finally, we were limited by the attrition rate and exclusion criteria of the original clinical trials, and therefore our cohort did not include patients with important confounding diagnoses like CHF, COPD, and pneumocystis. Overall, I believe this study raises an important question, asking whether deep learning can be employed to improve quality of healthcare in low-resource settings, particularly when it comes to challenging diagnostic tasks. We hope that future work will continue to explore the algorithm clinician relationship and discover new ways that deep learning can be integrated into existing healthcare infrastructure. Finally, I want to thank my co-first authors of this paper, Pranav and Amit, as well as the team members that put in tireless work on this project, Nishit, Jason, and Amir, our collaborators in South Africa, Mark Mendelson, Gary Martins, Daniel Van Hovig, and Rulin Griesel, as well as our mentors, Tom Boyles, Andrew Ng, and Matthew Lungren.